said to me that during this season that I have a responsibility to teach his people how to continue the journey. To see what happens is when we first get into this thing, we first get into the church, we're excited, we're happy, everything is going well. But sometimes if we're not careful, we'll get into church, and I have to be honest with you, as an adult, the most pain I ever have faced in my life as an adult, it happened in the church. The most hurt, the most disappointment that I've had, that I've experienced, and it's personal to me. But I don't think it's just personal to me, but I think some other people have had that same experience. There's some people you know that you invite to church, and they say, I'm not going to church. I ain't fooling with those church folks. What I've been through, and it's because they've been hurt. But what I want you to understand is, there's some folks, let's be honest, and we're going to talk about this today, that's been assigned for that reason. And so what we got to understand is, how do we deal with people who show up in the church and they have only one assignment, and that assignment is to work for the devil? I'm sorry to have to say that to you, but that's a fact. And so if we don't come to grips with that fact, we'll end up being like some folks who say they never going back to church no more because of this happened to them in the church and that happened to the church. But I want to tell you today that we don't have to do that. And I'm going to make it my mission to teach you that no matter what we go through in the church, God is with us. And he's going to stand with us when everything else fails. Matthew chapter 13, verses 24 through 30. Another parable he put forth to them, saying, the kingdom of heaven is like a man who sowed good seeds in his field. But while men slept, his enemy came and sowed tares among the wheat and went his way. But when the grain had sprouted and produced a crop, then the tares also appeared. So the servant of the owner came and said to him, sir, did you not sow good seeds in your field? How then does this have tares? He said to them, an enemy has done this. The servant said to him, do you want us then to go and gather them up? But he said, no, lest while you gather up the tares, you also uproot the wheat with them. Let both grow together until harvest. And at the time of harvest, I will say to the reapers, first gather together the tares and bind them in the bonds to burn them. But gather the wheat into my bonds. Amen. When you're around young people, they always use this term, you just faith. Usually they'll follow that and say, I just can't stand faith folks. And usually, you know, they're saying that because they're looking at one of their peers who's really sort of acting funny and not treating them right or trying to be something that they're not. So in other words, they look at them and they say, you imitate it. You are counterfeit. You're not real. And you know, as I think about it, as I look at this text, truthfully, that's what Jesus was talking about. When I look at this parable, there's a couple of terms that he used that we want to clarify before we go further, but when he says the kingdom of heaven, he's really talking about the church here on earth. And when he says the Son of Man, he's talking about Jesus. And when he talks about the good seeds, he's talking about God's word. And when he talks about the field, he's talking about the church universal. In other words, he's talking about the church everywhere. And the seeds, then, that are planted in the church universal. And then he begins to talk about this tares versus the wheat. And when we began to look at the tares that versus the wheat, one thing I realized is that the tares and the wheat closely resembles each other. They look alike. But the thing about the tares is poison, and the wheat is not. See, that wheat and the tares is hard to distinguish then the tares from the wheat. The only way you know really to make the distinction is once the harvest has happened, once they are in full bloom. But in the meantime, the tares and the wheat look the same. And so the thing about the tares is really, if you will, an unwelcome guest. Just hanging out with the wheat. The tares really is counterfeit wheat. But when you have them there, and they're growing together, you can't distinguish the one from the other. And you know, I thought about that when you get into church. Every now and then you'll get some, lack of a better word, fake Christians. You get some counterfeiters. Now, they resemble real Christians. But the thing about them is that they're poisonous to the church. Oh yeah, they cause division. They create confusion. They can criticize everything. Instead of bringing people to church, they run people out of the church. Instead of loving God with all their heart, all their soul, and all their mind, all their strength, they really don't care much about God. Instead of them loving their neighbor as their self, they tear down their neighbor because their neighbor is not them. All these counterfeit Christians, and I know they exist because I've seen them before. I'm not describing something that's some far away thing that doesn't really exist. See, when you're honest, and it's easy to be honest after you've had experience, because somewhere out there, experience is the best teacher. As I looked in at these counterfeit Christians, I see as Jesus in this parable, really he gives us some insight. But not only do he really give us some insight, but he also gives us some hope. And as I look then at these fake people that you encounter in the church, I want you to understand something. The first thing I realize is Jesus told us here in this parable, number one is that these counterfeiters sneak in on you. It's right there in the text. And in verse 25, Jesus said, while the men were asleep. So in other words, if the counterfeiter, if the tares showed up while you were sleeping, they show up when you're unaware of it. In other words, when you least expect it, here comes this counterfeiter. In other words, while you're focusing on Jesus, while you're resting from your labor, all of a sudden, here comes the counterfeiter. Ease right on in. Sit in the pew right beside you. Whispers in your ear. And all of a sudden, before you know it, you got problems in the church. You got rumors spreading all over the church. You got confusion from the back door to the pulpit. You got division on both sides of the aisle. Because all of a sudden, these counterfeiters sneak in. Oh, I remember watching. I like, you know, I'm an old cop, so I like these police investigating kind of shows. And I was watching CSI once, and we had this man who had some real wonderful art. In fact, he was a professional art collector, and he had art in his house worth millions of dollars. But how people were getting into his house. And so the CSI, you know, they're smart. They put this stuff together. And they said, now, wait a minute. This got to be an inside job. Something is wrong. We had no break-ins. We don't see the alarm is not going off. We see nobody on the camera. How can this art keep getting stolen? And all of a sudden, you know they're smart. They're going to figure it out. They realize that there was a son who lived in the house was stealing the art. But look what he was doing, though. Not only was he stealing the art, he was taking the art and he was replacing it with a counterfeit. And I hear this man, who's the dad, that's his house, and his son, right under his nose, was taking the art worth millions of dollars and replacing it on the wall with art that was worth nothing. And I thought about that. Here this man should have seen, should have known that here his son is right there under his nose, and he was ripping him off. And I thought to myself, that's what happens in the church often. Oftentimes we accept people, they come in, oh, they're so holy, oh, they're so yes. But all of a sudden, right under our nose, they come in and cause us all kinds of confusion. Counterfeiters who sneak in right under your nose. Second thing I see in this text that happens in the church if you're not careful. The thing about these counterfeiters, these tariffs, if you do, they're sent by Satan. It's right there. It's a little subtle, but it says, the Bible says, his enemy, here it is, came and sold the tariffs amongst the wheat. And now, who is the biggest enemy of the church? Satan. Who is the biggest enemy of Christ? Satan. And the thing about Satan is that he plants these counterfeiters, yeah, in the church. And the reason that he doesn't, in my view, is that he doesn't to stop progress. He doesn't to cause confusion. He doesn't to push his own agenda. He does it. So once he finished, yeah, he rolled out the door. It's right there in the text. In verse 25, he said he sold the tariffs and he went his way. So usually, when the counterfeiter comes, they're not permanent. It don't take long, really. All they got to do is throw a little decision over here, throw a little decision over there, throw a little decision right there. And after they finish, the whirlwind is gone. And they walk out the door. Oh, I know. We don't really like to talk about this stuff in the church because we want to think everybody here is here for the right reason. I'm just going to have to tell you that everybody is not here for the right reason. But that's all right. And the third thing is that they look like everybody else. It's right there. It was really subtle, but in verse 26 he says, now, the grain sprouted, it produced this crop, and the tares appeared, which means then that the tares and the wheat was mixed in together. Okay. Let me make it make sense. In the church, then, if we don't understand the wheat and the tares mixing and looking the same. In the church, all counterfeiters wear the same clothes they're in church. When they leave church, the songs that they sing and listen to are not the same songs that they sing and listen to while they're in the church. And I'll be honest with you. I'll be honest with you. There are some folks who not reading books that's biblical when they're not at the church. And some of the places they hang out, probably not so holy as it is when they're in the church. So all I'm trying to say is that they all look the same. But the thing about it is that they're imitators. That they're faking. That they're counterfeiters, if you will. And the next thing, my fourth point, I'm done. I know that as I talk about these counterfeiters, everybody probably down in their mind saying, we got to get them out of here. I know, I got it. We don't need them kind of folks around here. We got to get them out of here. My fourth point is this. Although we will have counterfeiters from time to time, brothers and sisters, we need to rest assured that God will deal with them. It's right there in the text. In verse 28, the servants basically said to the master, do you want me to go handle those turks? Do you want me to go get rid of them? And I thought about us in the church. Whenever we figure out there's a counterfeiter amongst us, the first thing we want to do is kick them out. Get them out of the church. But my question, though, is if we kick them out of church, where do we expect them to go? Now, if the church now, my understanding is the church is a place where the saved folks are. And if the saved folks' responsibility is try to win the unsaved to Christ, if we kick them out of the church, how then do we expect them to ever be saved? If the church is the place now where the lost can be found again, and we get mad because we find out they're faking and we want to kick them out of the church, where do we expect them to go to ever be found again? I don't know, right? If the church is a place where the captive can be set free again, and we get mad and want to kick people out because we realize that they're faking and they're imitators and they're counterfeiters, where do we think that they're going to go to ever be free again? Listen, Jesus said that the thing about it is this. He came to save. He came to save the lost. So if Jesus came to save the lost, and we encounter lost right here in the church, we still have to be in the business of trying to save the lost. We can't just kick them out. Oh, is it hard to put up with that kind of stuff? Yeah. Is it hard to deal with people you know not real? Yeah. But we don't just throw them away. Because if we throw them away, then we're failing to do what God has called us to do. Oh, I know. Oh, I don't like it either. I don't like that. I don't like the fact that when people smile in your face and pretending to be something they're not, and they're not, I don't like that bit more than you do. But God said that we are called as our commission to save, to reach the lost. And counterfeiters basically are just lost. They're just lost. There's something that's blocking their connection to God. And maybe we're the only connection that they will ever have to God. So we can't push them out the door. We just got to pray for them. And so listen, saints. I know it's frustrating. And nobody's probably gets more frustrated about these kinds of things than I do. But I tell you the truth. We have to stand with them. And here in the text, and I'm almost done, I realize in this whole thing that God has the final word. The text says in verse 30, Let both grow until the harvest. And here we go. Remember I said that God has the final word. And the harvest here is, in this context, is judgment day. And so the Bible teaches us that we all must appear before the judgment seat of Christ. And so God speaks. And he said, now when the harvest comes, he says, gather all together at the harvest. But he says about the tares, to get the tares and take them and bundle them up. And you cast them into hell, because he says, bundle them up and burn them. And so if you're going to take them then at the harvest, but we got to be able to hold out to the harvest. Now, we don't create the harvest. God creates the harvest. So we can't take no action. But when the harvest comes, when God takes action, he'll take care of it. But there's some good news, though. Remember I said he gave us insight, but he also gave us hope. Because in that text, he says that wheat is going to be gathered into God's bowl. And so those who are true Christians, those who are committed to God, those who are genuine, those who are true believers, they're going to have a chance to gather in God's bowl. Oh, yeah, the tares will be burning. And you know, you imagine that if you just think about it this way, if we, you know, you see those wheat fields, imagine sticking a match to a wheat field. Imagine how it would burn. But if the tares and the wheat is the same thing, imagine sticking a match to the tares and imagine how it would burn. And so when God has the final judgment, when God takes over, we don't have to worry about them. But in the meantime, hear me, we have to accept them. We have to keep praying for them.
Yeah.
We got to keep hoping for them. We got to keep witnessing to them.
Yeah.
We can't kick them out. Oh, I knew. Figured you, along the way, you're going to say, yeah, I know Pastor's going to say, get them, get them, get them. But no, God didn't tell us to get them, get them, get them. He told us to try to save them, save them, save them. So our hope then is that along the way, as we encounter these counterfeiters, and I'm really just, it's just a word of warning because it's going to happen. I just want you to know, but I want you to know what to do when it happens. Because I don't want us to be no people who kicking people out because they're sinners. I want us to be a people who embrace people and try to bring them closer to God. And so, you know, the thing about it is this. Simple as this. I understand that it's hard, but I understand too, because God has the final word, in spite of the counterfeiters, we here at AMR Gospel Service can still love God. We can still edify his people. We can still reach the community because God has the final word. And let's be honest. Jesus had his share of counterfeiters. Remember Judas, don't you? Counterfeiter. Remember the spies, don't you? Counterfeiters. Remember the Pharisees, don't you?
Yes.
Counterfeiters. Remember the Sadducees, don't you?
Yes.
Counterfeiters. But although Jesus was attacked by these counterfeiters, he still was able to perform his mission here on earth. I know he was. Because he was still able to give sight to the blind. He was still able to heal the sick. He was still able to feed the hungry. He was still able to raise the dead. He was still able, utterly, to die on the cross for our sin. Because Jesus was able to encounter his counterfeiters, and he still was able to fulfill the mission that God had sent him to fulfill, we as Christians today can continue to fulfill the mission on which God has called us. Don't worry about the counterfeiters. We can not have them. And in fact, I think that they're here to see what we're all about.
That's right.
reach the lost, to feed the hungry, to help heal the sick. Because remember, when Jesus left, he said, greater things than these. So all the things that he did, because his spirit is resting in us, we have the power then to help all those people who's lost, who's confused, and who's trying to divide us. But what we can't do, and I'm done, is that we can't follow them. We got to convince them to follow us as we follow Jesus. Let me add that to it. Well, they're just following us. We want them to follow us as we follow Jesus. And eventually, if we do that, I believe that they will be no longer counterfeiters, but they will be real. They'll be real. But the only way we can convince the people to be real is we have to be real. So, today was a message of warning, but it also was a message of hope. And also, it's a message of challenge. Because I challenge each and every one of you to go out and win people to Jesus in spite of themselves and in spite of yourself. We have an important mission here. And we can only do it when we accept all people all the time. Now, you don't have to accept their behavior, but you got to accept them as children of God, like all of us are. Today, I want to challenge you to go out. Some of you are going to go to work tomorrow, and you're going to encounter somebody who's always got their Bible with them, but they act like they don't know nothing in their Bible. Some of you may go home, and I pray that this is not true, but I know facts are facts. Reality is reality. You may have to go home to somebody who say they love God, they believe in God, but they act like they have no connection with God whatsoever. But I want to challenge you to begin to pray for that person. I want you to go and pray for them that God will set them free. Because if our mission then is to bring people to Christ, we got to accept them, even though we know some stuff about them. And you know why that's so important? Because God accepts us, and he knows everything about us. I better say that again. Because I know we get self-righteous sometimes. God accepts us, and he knows everything about us. And let's be honest, there's some things you know about yourself you don't even want to accept. Oh, yeah. Oh, I know we look good in here today. Yeah. But I also know that none of us in here are perfect. And so when we encounter these counterfeiters, that's really the thrust of what I want us to understand. They're coming. We're going to face them. It's our reality. But what do we do about it? And we must understand